Ever built an automation workflow to find out that the data is not flowing correctly? Maybe data is missing, maybe data is corrupted, maybe data is incorrectly formatted, maybe data is not something that you expected. Welcome to my course on AI automation powered by n8n. In today's lesson, I'm going to talk in detail about how data is structured in n8n, how it flows between different nodes, what is JSON, what is a list, how the items are present in n8n and what do they mean, how they flow through one node to another node. All this knowledge will help you manipulate, transform, and move data in an optimized manner so that you understand the foundations of data structures in n8n and can troubleshoot any kind of data mysteries in your workflows. Before we dive into how data is structured in n8n, it is very important to understand what is a JSON. JSON stands for JavaScript Object Notation. It is a standard structured format in which different applications pass data or share data between each other. Imagine you are placing an online order on an online store. You could place an order like smartphone, or you could also place an order like a t-shirt. So both these orders get stored in the system where you are placing the order, for example, Amazon. So if you are placing an order on Amazon, the data is stored in Amazon database. What kind of data? The order number, your name, your details like address, phone number, how to contact you so that the orders can be delivered to you. What item did you order? What are the properties of that item? What was the price of that order? The payment details, all this information gets stored. But how is this information stored? The first thing that comes to mind that you can store this kind of information in a tabular format that has rows and columns. Columns could be like different properties like the order number, your item details, your order details, your address, your shipping address details, and so on, right? However, this kind of tabular format does not give you flexibility because a smartphone will always have different properties than a t-shirt. A t-shirt could be like a cotton t-shirt, linen t-shirt. However, when you are ordering smartphone, it could have screen size, it could have memory size, it could have capacity. So all these properties of a smartphone are always different. Hence, whenever you need such kind of flexibility, as well as you require a structured format to save your information, that's where JSON steps in and it provides you the ability so that you can be flexible and still store data in a structured format. Let's look at the example. Think of JSON as a digital data storage containing key value pairs. So over here, if you look at the order number, this is more like a key, and ORD001 is the value. Similar to when you are storing this kind of data in a structured table format, then order number could be your column, whereas a row value would have a value of ORD001. Similarly, we have customer name, address, there is order. In the order, you can nest another object called product. You can see that product is a key over here, and the value is a list of properties the product has. So over here, this order number ORD001 with order details has a product which is only a single product, and you can say that Y name is the name of the product, type is smartphone, screen size, capacity, price, quantity, and status. Status is shipped. So for this particular first order that I placed for a smartphone, this is the data that gets stored in JSON format. But now if we look at the t-shirt, you can see that this data is almost identical in nature. Here we have order number as ORD002, customer name is same, address is same. So you can see that header information for first three or four values are almost same. But when we look at the order details over here, you would see product is there, and product again has a list of values, which you can see now easily. I can say name is Avengers t-shirt, color is red, material is cotton, size is medium, price is this, quantity is this, its status is this. So this way, JSON allows you to give flexibility in storing different kind of properties, but in a same structured format. This is the example where I placed two orders, one for t-shirt, the other one was for smartphone, and both the orders got stored in the database as JSON format. If I had to use tabular format, then it would have become very rigid in nature, because for each type of product, I would have to create different tables because they would have different columns to store that data. So that way it becomes very rigid in nature. nature. And since it's a flexible text format and text is universal in nature, JSON is widely popular to be used as a data exchange format between different applications or systems because it can be easily transferred, it can easily be compressed, it can easily be transformed, it can easily be filtered, it can easily be parsed, it can easily be processed. Think of JSON like a bento box which has different compartments in a single box, and you can fit small meals, large meals, sweet, tangy, different types of things can be placed in different compartments in a bento box. But if you are looking at a tabular format or kind of a spreadsheet, then the compartments in the bento box will be of same size and you will have to fit each of your meal type or sub meals into the same size compartment even if it does not fit over there. So you might end up eating less protein and more carbs because you cannot be flexible in putting your meals in the portions that you expected to eat. Now you must be wondering that I placed two different orders for two different products. What if I want to place a single order but both the products are part of that single order? Then how will JSON store the information for multiple type of products having different kind of attributes? That's where a data structure called list or an array will come into play, and we will see how we can store multiple items in the form of a list. So now let's look at a single order with multiple products in it. So you can see the header kind of information is still remaining same. We have order number as ORD003, customer name is same, address is still there. Then the order node is still there, and the value of order node is products instead of a single product. Now I'm calling the key over here as products, and you can see there is the square bracket that has begun. So the notation of this square bracket, it is starting over here and it is ending over here. Anything in between is considered as a list or an array. So there you can store multiple items inside these square brackets. The moment you put square brackets in JSON, anything inside it is considered a list of items or an array of items. So here, first product you can see, again, it starts with the curly braces. The first name is iPhone, type is again smartphone, screen size is this, storage capacity. Now if we look at the second product over here, you can see I have placed a comma. That means the first item is complete after the first curly braces end. Then you can place a comma and start another item, and you can see now the second product or item is name equals to Avenger t-shirts, which is similar to what we had in the first example when we were explaining two orders with single products. So same details are captured over here, and it is not necessary that both these products should follow same number of properties. The smartphone can have, like, let's suppose 7 attributes. Over here, this t-shirt may have like 5 attributes. Maybe it does not have a color, maybe it does not have a size. It does not matter, as long as you are storing the information in curly braces. This is the kind of flexibility that JSON provides, and hence it is widely popular. In the first example, we had 2 delivery boxes with 1 item each inside those delivery boxes. However, in the example 2, we had 1 big delivery box having 2 different items delivered to our doorstep. JSON lets us describe both these different types of situation in a more clear and flexible format than a table structure would have done. So this is the list data structure that helps you save multiple items in a single list. A single list could be list of customers, list of orders, list of transactions, and it is an important aspect in automation because lists help us traverse through multiple items, process those multiple items, process that multiple kind of data in our automation workflows. Now let's understand how will you access these properties to get the values from the JSON extracted out, like how do you parse this JSON format. For that, I'll just repeat that JSON is a structured key value pairs. The key is like a label, example customer name, and the value is the actual information stored inside the key, more like John Doe in our example. How do you access data in JSON? You use the dot notation. In the first JSON format and example where we had 2 separate orders, each with 1 product, let's assume our JSON data is stored in a variable called orders. Since it is plural, That means orders is list of orders. That means it would have multiple orders inside it. That means it would start with an index, much like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So these indexes are the position of the items. So in the first example, we had two orders placed, one for each item. So in order to access the first order, we would use 0. In order to access the second order, we would use 1, because index in the list always starts with 0. So first position is 0. That's why if I write orders and then this square bracket starts, like I said, any kind of list or array in JSON is described by square brackets. Over here we have square brackets, inside it you would write 0. That means you are trying to access the first order. And when you write dot, this is the dot notation, and order underscore number is a property of that order stored in JSON. So that's how you access orders. Square brackets, 0 inside as an index, first order is grabbed. Then you write dot, then you write order underscore number, it will return you ORD001. Then when you say orders, then square brackets 1, that means you are trying to access the second order, and you write dot customer underscore name, it would return you John Doe. Similarly, if you want to access the name of the product, you will keep on appending the dot notation in each of the object that is stored in a JSON. So for the first order, I'll write orders square bracket 0. That means first order is selected. Then I'll write dot, then order, because I have to reach the order. Then inside order, we had product. Then I'll write dot product. And inside the product, we had a property called name. So I'll write product dot name. That will return me iPhone. Similarly, if I have to return the price of the product in the second order, I would use orders square bracket 1 dot order dot product dot price. That would return me $19. So what's happening over here is you're trying to access the array which is stored inside. Since the outer structure is an array or a list, you would use an index, example orders square bracket 0, to select a particular order. Then you would use the dot notation to access one of its properties, for example order number or customer number. And finally, because we have nested objects inside it, for example in our case order is an object which is the parent object, inside the order we have a product object as well. So in order to access that, we'll keep on expanding the dot notation. That would be orders square bracket 0, which is the first order, then dot order, then dot product, then dot name would take you to the product name. Similarly, in the second example where we had one order with multiple products, let's assume our JSON data is stored in a variable called order data. Because a single order was returned, so we don't have the array or list of orders. Hence order data dot order underscore number would help us get to ORD003 as value. And if I have to go into the products, now products are a list of products inside what? Inside an order. Hence what we will do is order data dot order dot products, and because it's a list, I'll start the square brackets, write 0 dot name. That would give me access to the first product and it will return me iPhone. And if I have to select the second product, then I'll just use order data dot order dot product square bracket 1 dot price. That would return me $19. So what's happening over here is that you can directly access the properties like order number and customer name, since they are in the main object itself. And then product is an array property, or a list of products are there. So to access an individual product, we have to use its index. That's why we are using the product square bracket 0. And the chaining is happening, which is more like nested values are there. You combine the dot notation of array indexing, that is more like order data dot order dot products square brackets dot name. And if you are wondering why I am stressing so much on JSON, well, JSON, like I said, is a universal format exchange between different systems. And when we are working in n8n, we are going to talk to different systems out there, be it CRMs, be it ERP systems, be it Google Sheets, be it like API, Slack messages, Discord messages. There are so many apps that we are going to integrate, and all of them we are going to talk with the universal notation called JSON. Hence, understanding JSON is a very, very critical and foundational aspect for building AI automations in n8n. In n8n, these lists are handled as items. Items is nothing but a collection of individual items which are individually processed by a single node. So if you have a list of items entering a single node. That single node is going to process all the items that are coming from input and then produce the output in the same number quantity of the items. What this means is that every single node processes each single item separately, applying every logic that is configured inside that node to each of the items which are coming as a list of items as an input into the node. And don't worry, it is going to get very clear as soon as I'll share my screen and start working in the n8n workspace, start showing you how the data is flowing, how the data is processed. Just stick to this theoretical part for a bit, and I'm promising you that I'll jump into and explain all these concepts step by step using an example, using my screen share, so that you're following it very, very clearly. An example could be if your trigger node fetches multiple items or multiple orders. For example, you are working with a customer data order kind of a workflow, then each node that is going to be there in your workflow is going to process each individual order separately, so that every logic that you have built in your workflow automation, it is applied to every single order that is being input at the start of the workflow. And now I'm going to take you on a screen share and show you exactly this kind of an example using a workflow.